Okay, first I would like to thank for the invitation to this stupendous symposium on Carlo Fontana. As a German scholar who is confronted with Carlo Fontana's architectural activity since more than 15 years now, I'm very glad for the opportunity to present some of my results concerning Carlo Fontana's direct and indirect relations to the German Holy Roman Empire. Thanks to Eric Wegerhoff, as well as to Andrea Spiriti, Marcello Fagiolo, and Giuseppe Bonaccorso, now we are all together well instructed about Carlo Fontana's most ambitious design, so that I need not to give any more explanation about the project for a memorial church to be built inside the arena of the antique Colosseum. Although being published posthumous in 1725 as part of an archaeological monograph on the Flavian Amphitheater, that design of a domed church in connection with an oval ambulatory had some astonishing impacts on some German building projects which are dating about 15 years before the publication of the named book. Unfortunately, most of these epigonous designs remained unexecuted, so that they shared the same fate like the model which they followed. My first protagonist of German architects who had insider knowledge of Carlo Fontana's Colosseum project will be the Viennese imperial court engineer Johann Lukas Hildebrandt. Born in 1668 in Genoa as Giovanni Luca Hildebrandt, he was given in the early 1680s to Carlo Fontana's studio as a long-term trainee. Later, Hildebrandt will give evidence of his own that he assisted Carlo Fontana, quote, since the outset of his adolescence. Here you see the original report of Hildebrandt, and I underlined the most important words, which you can understand also in Italian or English. So the outset of his adolescence means the age of 14, respectively, the year of 1682. Biographical evidence let him return to his hometown about 1693, so that he could have stayed in the Fontana workshop as a so-called giovane for the minimum of 10 years. During his long term of formation, he had enough opportunities to copy plans for the purpose of collecting study material. Today, this collection, which Hildebrandt used extensively during his professional activity as design patterns, is unfortunately lost. Part of it, as we will see, must have been the Colosseum project. In the case of Hildebrandt, we have to pay attention to the chronological circumstance that he knew the Colosseum project in its first state before Carlo Fontana's revision of his design in occasion of the Holy Year 1700. That first state, in which the church is surrounded by an arcaded colonnade instead of pillar arcades, was discovered by Helmut Hager under Pentimento in the ground plan of the design drawings conserved at Sir John Soane's Museum in London. Hildebrandt received his first opportunity to use the Colosseum project as design pattern in 1707. Meanwhile, he had started a professional career in Vienna as imperial court engineer since the late 1690s. In 1704, a prestigious private commission coming from the sphere of Austrian high nobility fell to him with the building of the Capuchin Loreto Sanctuary in the small Bohemian town Rumburg, which is located in the north of the country nearby the Saxon border. After the initial design of a mostly true copy of the Loreto Santa Casa, which could have been built in the following years. Subsequently, in 1707, Hildebrandt delivered the design of an ambulatory in connection with a double-towered chapel and a palace-like building for housing a boys' choir. Without any doubts, we can all recognize that the oval concept of the sanctuary complex derived from Carlo Fontana's Colosseum project. The substructure cells of the seat rows are turned into radiating chapels and confessional cells, while the dome of the analogous double-towered church is eliminated and a habitation building is added. As a design pattern, Hildebrandt obviously used the predecessor of Carlo Fontana's ground plan combined with a section in which the complex of the memorial church and its ambulatory is embedded in the ruins of the Flavian Amphitheater. Not only that, the characteristic scenery of the double-towered memorial church in the center of one of the narrow oval curves determines extraordinarily Hildebrand's section drawing, but the confrontation of the two ground plans by scaled adjusting of the ovals brings to light that Hildebrand was careful to adapt the proportions of the design pattern as far as possible. Indeed, he had widened the ambulatory, but the radiating chapels are running within the inner ring of the antique substructure cells. Please have a special look on the fountain, which recurs on the Fontana della Madonna, located in the forecourt of the original Loreto Sanctuary, because it is situated at the same place as that one in Carlo Fontana's design. And naturally, also the heat of the arcades is in its depending from the transverse diameter of the oval follows the used design pattern. It's a pity that none of Hildebrand's precious design was built because of the exaggerated sumptuousness of the building complex and the therefore suspected high building costs. In difference to the just showed close imitation of Carlo Fontana's Colosseum project, Hildebrand remembered again its scenic qualities merely in a more superficial way. This happened about two decades later, exactly in the year of 1724, when he was designing a main entrance pavilion as part of a planned restructuring and enlarging of the imperial castle in Vienna. Now a rotunda is embedded in an exedra of a relatively slight depth, what means in comparison with the design pattern that in this case, not the dome of the church, but its towers are eliminated, while the remaining domed cylinder is stretched massively into the heat. In the end, also this building project was refused, now not truly in consideration of too much sumptuousness, but rather of missing pomposity. By the way, it is remarkable that Bruno Grimschitz, the author of the main monograph on Hildebrand, first published in 1932 and re-edited in 1959, could recognize in the entrance pavilion of the Imperial Castle project the one and only considerable influence of Carlo Fontana on Hildebrand's art of architecture. From the today's point of view, Grimschitz underestimated immensely the relation between teacher and pupil. The underestimation caused on the one hand in the fact that Eduard Kudenhove Erthal, who wrote the German monograph on Carlo Fontana, knew little about Hildebrand as well as Grimschitz did about Carlo Fontana, though that both scholars had been unable to recognize the real relation between the both architects. On the other hand, in the German-speaking lands, Carlo Fontana had for a long time a very bad fortuna critica, as you like to say here in Italy. This was the famous Viennese art historian Hans Siedlmeier's fault, who recognized in Carlo Fontana a poor epigone of the Baroque genius Gian Lorenzo Pernini, and therefore an artist in Carlo Fontana, therefore an artist who is unworthy to pay him any art historical attention. Yesterday, Werner Oechslin told us the background of this extreme side of view. Grimschitz held a private friendship with Siedlmeier, and trusting in the opinion of his friend and colleague, he came to the convincement that Hildebrand could not learn anything noteworthy at Carlo Fontana's workshop. As a way out of that supposed lack of Roman formation, Grimschitz let Hildebrand become an epigone of the Piedmont mathematician and architect Guarino Guarini, and of the elder Roman-trained architect and Viennese colleague Johann Bernhard Fischer von Erlach. All in all, an immense distortion of the truth resulting from ignorance and prejudice. Looking back, I consider myself as the first German-speaking scholar who has taken consequently serious Hildebrand's formation as a pupil of Carlo Fontana, and fitted with comprehensive knowledge about the latter mostly provided by Helmut Hager, I was, for example, able to discover the Rumburg-Loreto project as a Fontanesque capolavoro of Hildebrand. And I want to mention that Giuseppe Bonaccorso wrote a short article, but very fine article, about the Borromanism of Hildebrand. And this was one of the only few contributions about the true contributions about the Roman formation on Hildebrand in the literature, which was written until now. Comparable misinformation characterizes also the interpretation of the relation between Carlo Fontana and the Dresden court architect Matthäus Daniel Pöppelmann, my second protagonist of German architects who had insider knowledge of the Colosseum project. When the German architect Hermann Heckmann wrote the main monograph on Pöppelmann, which was published in 1972, Codenhove Erthal's monograph from 1930 was still again the one and only German source of information about Carlo Fontana. And, this is important, a very insufficient one. On the other hand, Codenhove Erthal could have known also only little about Pöppelmann, with the result that chronological mistakes and wrong observations were changing when it was spoken about the probable relations between Carlo Fontana and Matthäus Daniel Pöppelmann. Codenhove Erthal took one obvious Fontanesque design of Pöppelmann, a coup d'honneur for Dresden residential castle with a towered gate, emblematically as a vignette of his chapter on Carlo Fontana and the foreign countries. The arcaded exedra with a tower in its center derives, as we all can see, from the Colosseum project and is the first design example which I want to introduce to the audience of this conference. The original of Pöppelmann's drawing is unfortunately lost since World War II, so that only book illustrations of it can give us a weak imagination of the sheet. Like Hildebrand, Pöppelmann undertook an exchange of components, here the substitution of the church by a three-storied tower. Furthermore, it is comparable with his Viennese colleague that Pöppelmann adapted not only geometrical figurations and architectural motifs, but also main proportions of Fontana's design in connection with the ruins of the Flavian Amphitheater. In this case, there are relations between the heat of the arcades and the diameters of the exedra, respectively the arena, as well as between the width of the courtyard and the substructure rings of the amphitheater. Although Codenhove Erthal had identified the right design pattern used by Pöppelmann, no care about the right chronology and the way of mediation was taken by Hermann Heckmann when he dated that design of a coup d'honneur together with the affiliated project of renewing and enlarging Dresden residential castle in the years before Pöppelmann's Roman sojourn. But by that time, no contemporary, with the exception of a few insiders, could have had any knowledge of Carlo Fontana's Colosseum project. In my recent research on Pöppelmann, I try as a partial revision of Heckmann's monograph to bring to light all the evidences which make sure that and in which way Pöppelmann used designs of Carlo Fontana as pattern. The misinformation about that topic is mirrored by the fact that until today the evidence for an encounter between Pöppelmann and Carlo Fontana was overseen. According to the inventory of his estate, Pöppelmann possessed the second edition of Carlo Fontana's Discorso sopra l'antico monte citatorio situato nel Campo Marzio, published in 1708. This is insofar remarkable because Carlo Fontana's treatise was the only Italian book of Pöppelmann's private library, a fact which gives strong evidence that he was obviously not common with the Italian language. Of this reason, the named book could hardly be owned as a result of a normal purchase. For my opinion, it was Carlo Fontana's author's gift at the occasion of Pöppelmann's Roman sojourn of 1710. In that year, Pöppelmann was sent to Rome in an official mission as court architect of the Polish King Frederick Augustus I, better known as Augustus the Strong, who reigned at the same time as Prince Elector of Saxony. Pöppelmann was given the order, which I quote in English, the order to study in Rome current palace and garden architecture and to meet the most prominent architects to discuss with them a project for rebuilding Dresden residential castle, end quote. One of that most prominent architects of Rome he met surely was nobody else than Carlo Fontana. Documentary evidence, let's suppose that Pöppelmann's sojourn could not last more than 2 months. But this short time gave him not much opportunity to take detailed copies of plans like the Colosseum project for collecting usable design patterns. I have found another way of mediation, namely the use of copperplate prints. In context with Carlo Fontana's Colosseum project, I discovered in the Dresden art collections an unnoticed series of copperplate proof prints of the illustrations prepared by Carlo Fontana for the book on the Flavian Amphitheater. This series of 24 sheets, yet without the later book pagination, is comparable to the known series of copperplate proof prints, which is conserved at the Museo di Roma as part of Carlo Fontana's book manuscript, and which had been edited by Helmut Hager in 2002. The Dresden copies, as being today conserved at the public state collection of drawings and prints, the so-called Kupferstich Kabinett, were formerly part of the Saxon Princely Graphic Collection. Of this reason, I believe that they were the official gift of Carlo Fontana to Augustus the Strong, which Pöppelmann had to deliver to Saxony, and which from that time onwards he could use as design pattern. Unfortunately, it is not the place here to remember the long-enduring connections between Carlo Fontana and Augustus the Strong, resulting in the title of a Polish count, which the architect received in 1699. Helmut Hager and at least William Eisler and Cristina Ruggiero gave comprehensively a report of that occurrences. Maybe that gratitude caused Carlo Fontana to donate Augustus the Strong about 710 current copperplate print production in occasion of the Dresden court architect's visit in Rome. So. So this is the section with the five sheets of the church project, and I continue now with I short my report. So a more superficial adaptation of the scenography of the Colosseum project is the Zwinger in Dresden, and a more close adaption is the Jägerhof project, and with which I want to close my report. May I? No, I want to read it. This short. Yes. Yeah. So the ambitious project for enlarging the hunting facilities yard in Dresden-Neustadt, the so-called Jägerhof, into a huge palace-like festivity area, including an oval amphitheater, should serve for animal hunting. In his presentation drawing, Pöppelmann adapted not only the ground plan of the Flavian amphitheater and the scenery of the section, but also Carlo Fontana's illusionistic illustration style by showing trombolet of rolled and torn paper sheets. The church is converted in a pavilion which houses the royal box. Again, Pöppelmann tried to adapt proportions as far as the conditions of the new draft led him to do so, with the result that his amphitheater is in the section mostly congruent with the ruins of the antique one, namely with the surviving parts of the seat rows, neglecting the inconsistencies that Pöppelmann gives along longitudinal section and Carlo Fontana transverse one. In the ground plan, the congruency between the design pattern and the depending draft switches indecisively between the different circular curves of the ovals, but it is comparable that Pöppelmann placed an open staircase in combination with a trapezoid entrance to the arena at that area, which serves in Carlo Fontana's ground plan as an atrium at the rear of the church. To sum up, in Johann Lukas Hildebrand and Matthäus Daniel Pöppelmann, we have got to know two insiders who had the opportunity to bring the main ideas of Carlo Fontana's Colosseum project to the German lands long before it could be published. The main ideas of the project are the oval layout and the special scenery of an arcaded exedra with a convex building in its center as an adverse effect. As mediators of knowledge, Hildebrand, as a long-term pupil and assistant of Carlo Fontana, used own copies of the original plans, while Pöppelmann, as a short-term trainee of Carlo Fontana, used current copperplate prints of the Flavian Amphitheater, which he had delivered as a gift of Carlo Fontana to the Saxon court. Both architects were concerned to adapt not only formal and scenographic qualities of the Colosseum project, but also certain proportional relationships between ground plan and section. The consequent representation of the Colosseum project in orthogonal projection supported the combining of the impressive scenery qualities as being shown by the section with more or less individual ground plans. In particular, I've tried to uncover these functional aspects of imitation as my current special interest of research on Carlo Fontana and his school, which is the practice of making architecture. Thank you for your attention.
Mi sono occupato io stesso in passato di questo problema. Ho coniato un termine, l'amfiteatro à habité, unendo insieme lo slogan di Le Corbusier sulla macchina habité con lo slogan, diciamo così, di Leonardo per il teatro da predicare, per un tema architettonico che arriva fino alla Reggia di Caserta, partendo dal Colosseo. In particolare un progetto per la Reggia di Caserta nel 1751 dell'architetto dilettante Diodati, che ho ricostruito negli ultimi 15 anni più volte, era esattamente un anfiteatro ovale messo davanti al palazzo, proprio come nello Jägerhof che abbiamo visto qui. E questo anche all'interno della storia del Colosseo, che nel Medioevo diventa una cittadella, una piccola sia fortezza che luogo abitato, e del resto è frequente nella storia delle riduzioni medievali delle città antiche, molte città si concentrano nell'anfiteatro, nel Colosseo. Poi, come dicevo l'altro giorno, si passa al progetto di Domenico Fontana, per una cittadella operaia all'interno del Colosseo e attraverso varie tappe l'idea del Colosseo come macchina perfetta, come modello e archetipo dell'architettura contiene anche questo elemento. Dico queste quattro perché dubito che riusciremo ad arrivare a un dibattito finale. Adesso diamo la parola a Martin Olin, che è professore associato a Uppsala, nonché direttore assistente dell'Istituto Svedese di Roma, che ha lavorato intensamente presso il Dipartimento Disegni e Stampe del Museo Nazionale di Stoccolma e curando in particolare il grande catalogo della collezione dei disegni di Nicodemus Tessin il Giovane. E la sua relazione parte proprio da una frase: il vecchio cavaliere Fontana è ancora vivo o no? E qui il rapporto fra Tessin e il Nord. Martin.